Good day once more, and of course a happy new year to all of you. Let's begin this year with a topic which I find very fascinating. It is the concept of having a mentor, and today I'll also discuss with you how you find the right mentor. Let me clarify that what I had spoken a few weeks back about having a role model, that and this are in no way connected to each other. Somebody asked me the other day, oh, you've done a session on role model, then why this mentor? Let me clarify. A role model may be a person whom you've never met in your life. Role model can be a celebrity. Role model can be somebody whom you deeply admire. It can be a guru. It can be Mahatma Gandhi or APJ Abdul Kalam or Mother Teresa or anybody like that. It could also be somebody who you have met, who is there in your vicinity, but who doesn't, you know, spend time in interacting with you. You're just observing that person. Let's say you have a teacher or a school principal or a grandfather whom you really respect, regard, look up to and say, wow, what qualities this person has got. I really wish I would also be able to imbibe these qualities. So that is what makes a person a role model. The role model is not actively involved in your growth, your development or your learning. Today, what we are going to talk about is mentors. A mentor is a person who is involved with you, who spends time, attention, and energy on you to ensure that your growth is better. You learn certain things in life, you develop into a better human being. And that is what is a mentor, which, as I said, is completely different from a role model. Let me also at this point clarify the difference between counselor, coach, guide, and mentor. Counselor, I think most of you are aware, is a person who listens to you, gives you an opportunity to come out with your deepest sentiment and emotions and experiences, helps you to calm down or to think better, to introspect. The counselor is, as I keep reminding, a mental mirror, shows you the mirror that this is what you're feeling, this is what is your priority, this is where you are progressing, this is where you are getting frustrated, and empowers you to take your own decision without guiding you, without telling you what to do, without pushing something onto you. The counselor is there for you. The counselor spends time and effort with you, but in a totally non-directive manner, in the sense that you lead your own life. Compare that to a coach. A coach is a person who actually takes you under control and teaches you. You may have, for example, the most common is a sports coach. You want to learn a particular sport and you have a coach who is an expert in that area. And that person tells you, you want to learn how to play tennis. He will show you which is the right racket, how do you hold it, how do you twist your arm, how do you exercise your gross motor and fine motor movements before doing this. And of course, a coach is not restricted to sports. The coach may be helping you, coaching you to move on into better. The coach also acts as a monitor to see what progress you are making, to correct you when you go wrong. The third one that I mentioned was a guide. A guide plays a similar role to a coach in the sense that the guide tells you what is good for you, what you should do, what are the ways and means of doing it, how you do it, but does not necessarily correct you if you are wrong or evaluate you whether you're doing correctly or not. The person has just guided you. Person has told you, okay, you want to become a tennis player. This is the procedure. These are the people who teach you. This is the clubs where you can join. This is how long it will take. This is how much your investment will be. And then backs off and allows you to do what you want. So this is what a counselor, a coach, or a guide does. Now, what does a mentor do? The mentor, as I said, is a completely different person. The most common form of a mentor was when we had our Gurukul system of learning and education. The guru was a mentor in the sense that the guru would take responsibility to make you what you are. Starting with evaluating what is good for you and what is not, you may not even know. And if you have a wrong direction, the mentor is a person who will stop you and say, no, you are headed in the wrong direction. You will regret or you will not progress sufficiently. So I take the responsibility of teaching you what is the right way. First, finding the right direction, setting the right goals, and then doing hand-holding while you proceed on that path which the mentor has told you. And the mentor will also be evaluating how well you have done, what you have done, what you are progressing. And the mentor is not restricted to a particular thing like a coach. You need a separate coach to learn a sport. You need a separate coach if you want to learn, let's say, grooming of yourself or learning how to do public speaking. But a mentor is a holistic person. Mentor looks into you as a composite entity, as a human being who needs to do so many things, even to prioritize. No, you're spending too much time in sports. Move away. Or vice versa. I think you're spending too much time without much of exercise. So my mentoring will also include guiding you how you can go and learn a particular game and which game would be most suitable for you. That's how the mentor goes. And I was just looking up all these things about mentors and this and that. I found a very nice short clip on the internet. I thought I'll just share it with you. Anis has downloaded it and brought it for you. That is a few very significant steps on what is a mentor. Mentoring is the act of making a difference in the life of the mentee. The ability to achieve results through people who you are when no one else is looking, knowing what is the best for you, honoring the greatness and uniqueness, and standing out from the crowd, connecting every day to your deepest and most enduring values, doing whatever it takes to, let's say, honor your word, care for others, make a difference through your work. This is what giving hope to the people around you. This is what mentoring is supposed to achieve. This is the process called mentoring. Trusting enough to be trusted. What a wonderful slogan, you know? Trusting enough to be trusted. And you should have a curious mind, a listening ear, and an open heart in order for that mentoring to take place successfully. Knowing that the biggest risk in life is not to take the risk. Making adversity your ally. Greatness is born through tough times and unexpected circumstances. Being able to rise to that challenge. Knowing when to come up for air. Knowing what from time to time you have to look backward to see forward. Excelling instead of competing. Having an irrational sense of hope beyond rationality. This, I thought, explains so beautifully about how an ideal mentoring process should take place. Now, in order to do that, you obviously need a mentor. Okay. So, as today's topic says, how do you find the right mentor? Finding the right coach for public speaking or sports or mathematics is not very difficult. To a great extent, finding the right counselor whom you can pour out to and find that relief and get empowered also is not that difficult. But let me tell you, finding a mentor is difficult. And you know what's the first step of finding a mentor? Being conscious and being convinced that I need a mentor. Very often I have asked people, you know, if you had to choose a mentor, if you want to make better progress in life, who would you choose among the people known to you or among the people whom you can get to know? Or what are the traits that you are looking for if you want to have a mentor? I come across people who say, I don't need a mentor. I know what to do. I am in charge of my own life. Why should anybody else control me or guide me or tell me what to do? I do respect such people. If you really have that type of, you know, self-worth and that feeling that, yes, I don't need anybody to tell me. But most important, it should be backed up with your abilities. If you do not have the right abilities, and if you say, I don't need a mentor, I can do things by myself. It's like somebody saying, I don't need a doctor, whether I fall sick or not. I can take care of my health. You should know how to take care of your health. You need not be a doctor, but you should have enough knowledge of what makes for good health and bad health, how to do preservation of health, prevention of illness, curing if illness comes. Then and then only you'll be able to say, I don't need a doctor. Now the doctor is restricted to your body. The mentor controls everything. The mentor may at some point also say that your physical health is not good. You need to see a doctor. You need to do something. You need to change your lifestyle. Maybe you need to do more exercise. Even that will be included in the mentoring process. So personally, if you ask me, I think having a mentor is a wonderful thing. It really enhances your life. And the beauty of it is that mentors need not be some great people, highly qualified and very well placed and all. In fact, let me tell you that people who are in very high positions or who have really been achievers sometimes may not be available to mentor you. They may be too busy. They may be involved in their own life, or they may be having too many people chasing them. So actually speaking, ideally speaking, a mentor should be somebody who's not too busy, who himself or herself is in the process of achieving higher levels. So the person shares with you their experiences. And the person has time to take care of your needs and your wants and to be able to not only grasp and understand what is happening to you and what should happen to you. At the same time, I do believe that the mentor should have had sufficient experiences of life. Age is not important. There are 20-year-olds who have really learned about life, and there are 80-year-olds who have never learned anything about life. So it's not that you have to have a particular age or whatever. It is. That is not important. But what is important is that the mentor should have had sufficient experiences of life. The mentor should have gone through some ups and downs, which has made the mentor think for themselves first before talking about mentoring others. The mentor also has to be knowledgeable in certain areas which you are going to be tackling or which you need to be building up in yourself. Along with that, you should have a mentor who is willing, like I was mentioning, somebody who has the time, somebody who can be close to you, somebody whom you can observe from a very close level. And that is why, as I said, the mentor need not be somebody very great, or very highly educated or qualified or a successful person. Sometimes the interesting thing is, mentors can be very simple and very humble people whom you don't even realize that I can learn from these people. You know what I did? I asked a few of my colleagues, do you have a mentor or have you had a mentor in your life? And if so, what did you benefit from that mentor? Okay, so let's listen to one of them who will tell you who is or was her mentor and how it helped her. So here is Sophia.
My mentor for my life is the auntie who lived in my neighborhood. She is no more, that is the saddest part, but yet I grew up seeing her with so many things in her life. She went through trauma and terminal illness, plus a lot of disturbance in her personal life. But one thing she carried with her, and I would like to treasure that in my life, is hope. She never lost hope in any situation. She had that confidence in her. I don't know how she did that. It's not easy, yes. But she had that smile, and that self-care within her was really inspiring to me. Now when I realize and go back in my thoughts, I feel that that is one of the things which I should treasure in my life. And you know, it is really empowering.
I hope you got the Hope you got the point. I purposely picked out of so many people whom I spoke to, who spoke about different types of mentors. I picked up on one or two whose mentors, as you heard Sophia also just now, not somebody very great, not somebody who's, you know, people who look up to them and all that, because sometimes very difficult for such a person to be a very effective mentor to you. The other thing is that the mentor should be genuinely interested in your welfare and in your development and in your progress. The mentor need not have the same skills, but yet the mentor can identify what is your potential and move on. And therefore, if you are going to select a mentor, at whatever stage of life you are in, it doesn't matter whether you're 15 or 50 or 90. It is never too late to have a mentor to look up to and take benefit from. And believe me, there are a lot of genuine people around, unselfish people around, who all you have to do is to approach them kindly and say that there are certain attributes, certain qualities in yours self which I admire, and I want you to explain to me, to show me and even guide me as to how I can build up certain qualities for myself. So to be able to do that, first do this simple exercise of finding out where you want to progress, in which direction, what are your goals, what are your needs, which are the areas where I'm progressing very smoothly by my own efforts and by my own knowledge, and which are the areas where I think I need some guidance, some help, some explanations. And then start looking around. It's a wonderful exercise. Quietly, don't even tell anybody. Look at that aunt of yours, as Sophia was telling you just now. Look at some teacher or even an ex-teacher. Look at somebody, you know, who is related to you or who's your neighbor or who's doing something great. Check out. I would actually suggest make a list. Have at least 1, 2, 3 people who are possible mentors. Once you have the, list, sound them off without saying I want mentoring. If you just approach somebody and say, I've seen certain qualities in you, the way you have dealt with life, so I felt I can learn something from you. Can you tell me something? Even hearing out that person, what that person has to say, definitely gives you that gut feeling. Yes, this person can be a good mentor. Then ask the person, if you were to, you know, help me, how would you like to go about doing the thing? How would you like to, you know, what do you think are my needs and how would you like to take me forward? For that mentor to be successful, the mentor should have some idea about your life, your experiences, your capabilities, your limitations, your aspirations, and your frustrations. And even if that mentor doesn't know, the mentor should be interested enough to first ask you a lot of questions. That's when you know that this person is genuine, and I think this person will definitely be able to be useful to you. A mentor should also be a person whom you regard and respect. As I said, not necessarily because of qualifications and achievements, but because of certain humane qualities in that person. Equally important is that the mentor should have the same value system as you have. That I think is very important. Because if that is not the case, the mentor may want to direct you to take a path which goes against your basic principles or your values. And things are not going to work out in that case. So make sure that you have a mentor who has the same values as yours, who is available on a regular basis. Ideally, preferably face-to-face in the presence, but in the worst case, by phone or by any other electronic means by which you can keep in touch with each other. And if there are certain areas where the mentor is not capable, don't use that mentor for that particular area. Look for somebody else and do it by yourself. If you have found the right mentor, you will see the benefit within no time. Let's hear Banu, what she has to say about her mentor and what she has learned from her.
Going through the tough time in my life, I was looking for the people who can help and guide me. When I shared what I was going through with one of my aunt, she understood me. Her support and guidance helped me a lot to face those challenges at little ease and overcome those situations. You know, I'm inspired by her knowledge and the approach towards the life. I'm thankful she was available when I was in need.
Simple, no? That's why I particularly selected these two, because their mentors were not somebody far away, somebody high up, somebody qualified. It can be very simple people. Sometimes, that's my personal experience, I have learned so much from simple, humble, very ordinary people whom nobody gives a second thought to. But if you try it out, you will see that they can be such wonderful mentors to help you in your journey. So once you start with a mentor, I would request you to periodically review. How much progress have I made? Am I in agreement with what the mentor is saying? Is the mentor being able to give me sufficient inputs for me to make, you know, good progress? What are my goals from time to time? Remember, goals keep changing. What goal you have now may not be the same 3 months or 3 years from now. And if it is going to be a long-term mentoring process, the mentor should be able to adapt to goals the way you are going through the thing. Also see if you can have the mentor as a role model. It's possible. Sometimes if you can find a mentor who you say, this is what I would like to be. This is what appeals to me. This is what would make me happy. I would like to be in the shoes of this person. Then it's a really fantastic thing. You have actually found a very good mentor because the mentor is automatically your role model. Equally important is your communication comfort level with your mentor. Are you able to speak anything and everything to your mentor? Are you able to ask the most touchy or sensitive questions to your mentor? And is your mentor the type of person who has the patience, the broad-mindedness, the maturity to be able to answer to you? And that makes a world's difference. From time to time, review that when my mentor says something, does my motivation level go up? My mentor gave me an appreciation or a positive stroke. My mentor told me that this path that you have taken is not a very comfortable one. You may not be able to progress. My mentor said, take another path. Did it put me down or did it motivate me? Hey, I'm so thankful to my mentor that they gave me a new direction. They pointed out that here I would have been stuck or my progress would have been slow. So whenever the mentor, you know, interacts with you, whenever the mentor guides you or tells you what to do, ask yourself, does my motivation level go up? If it does, you're absolutely on the right track. You have the right mentor, and your mentor is at the same time giving you the right guidance and doing course correction. See, to reach a goal, there can be so many different paths, isn't it? That is what sometimes confuses us. I may set goals for myself. I may say, this is my goal. This is what I want to achieve. This is what I want to do. But more important from the mentoring point of view is, does my mentor show me the correct path from time to time? It is not enough to just have goals. You should also know what is the direction or the path which takes me to the goal, and be ready to change your path. The same way as you want to go somewhere and you find that there's a huge traffic jam, you look for alternative routes and you say, even though this is longer, I'll take a left turn, right turn, I'll go roundabout, but I will reach faster than getting stuck in this traffic jam. No? The same thing applies to your life's journey. And that is the reason why you should be monitoring, you should be checking whether your mentor is from time to time able to show you the different paths. See, what happens is that when I am going, supposing I am going in a vehicle to a particular destination, I can see only in front of me or behind me or, you know, within that radius. But why do Google Maps or anything help? Because they have a bird's eye view. They are looking at it from the entire perspective of this journey and this goal and this path. And that is why they are in a better position to tell you that there is an alternative route, which is longer, but smoother and better in terms of time. When these things happen, you will get that thing. That is exactly what the mentor should be able to do. The mentor should primarily nurture you, but also should be able to convince you to change either your path or even goals at times. And you should feel connected enough. You should not feel upset that the mentor is taking me away from what I thought was the direction or the goal. These things do happen and can happen. Very often we neglect these areas. We just allow life on a day-to-day basis to go ahead. So think about it. I'll take my little break as usual. And Meera is here to update you on what's happening in Banjara and what you can do. I'll be back in a minute.
Hello everyone, happy new year. So like Ali was talking about how to find the right mentor and how a mentor, you know, checks your progress,
you know, gives you goal setting, is like your role model. So we at Banjara also talk the walk, walk the talk, and we have mentoring for all our programs. So let it be the course in CCAD, where that is the child and adolescent development course, where we, you know, break the group into 6 to 7 people, and each one is allotted a mentor to take you from A to Z, to make you understand all the nuances of the course. And, you know, understanding, communicating with you, taking that extra effort to make you understand. And we also have the IPCG, that is the International Program in Counseling Guidance. And, you know, there also you have a one-on-one mentor taking you through and throughout all the sessions through the year, and, you know, giving you that hand-holding and helping you set your targets and goals. Now, even with our course in DCS, that is the Diploma in Counseling Skills, we do have the mentoring. And it's not like, okay, chalo, you have started the course, now you get the material and you go forward with it on your own. No, it doesn't work like that. Each topic is handheld. Each person is taken forward. Doubts are cleared. Communications are open. The channel for communication is open. And we also have a very nice program on for children in life skills called Youngs and Blossoms. And though that is that's a summer camp that is held for half a month, but that also, there also children get their individual mentors to, you know, talk about whatever they would like to talk, and you know, share their mind, express themselves, because that is what mentors are there for, right? That they help you express yourself, help you reach where you want to reach. And when you see a mentor, you say that, oh yes, I want to be like this, or I want to do this, or how did you reach here? And that mentor guides you and takes you over there. And we also have free counseling here down at the academy, online, offline, you know, through the phone. We have email counseling where, you know, people come and share their thoughts. They share whatever they are going through, and it's in complete confidentiality. So it's like being non-judgmental, empathetic, and complete confidentiality, so that you feel at ease and you understand your mind better. So at Banjara, these are few ways where how we take mentoring forward and see to it that people are, you know, feeling good emotionally and mentally. Thank you very much, and over to Dr. Ali.
Yes, I'm back. And as I always keep saying, this is the more exciting part of the session, because I get to learn from you, I get to interact, I get to do a lot of introspection based on your comments and your questions. So I see some comments and questions already. Anis is going to put them on one by one, and let me see what open discussion we can have on it. We start with Asha. There may be disagreement between the mentor and the mentee, which may cause discord. Nevertheless, it need not affect their relationship. This is what I always tell, no? In any close relationship, there should be this concept of agreeing to disagree. And as long as your disagreement is on issues and not on personalities. This is something which I keep on reminding you people. Any close relationship, whether it's your mentor, whether it's your parent, whether it's your best friend, whether it's your boss, whoever it is in your life who is important to you and with whom you spend a lot of time, sometimes actually it is good to have disagreements. There's a very good message which I had learned when I was studying management years and years back. Our teacher, who was also a mentor in certain ways, he said, if in an organization there are two managers who always agree on everything, throw out one of them. Do you understand what is this person saying? He said, a manager is primarily a person who takes decisions, gives instructions, leads. Now, if there are two people who are doing exactly the same thinking, the same attitude, the same behavior, why do you need to pay two salaries? One man can do the same job, isn't it? So, if you have two managers, if you have a mentor and a mentee or whatever it is good to have disagreements because that provokes you, that makes you think. But as long as you have what I mentioned earlier, respect towards your mentor. If you do not doubt their intentions, if you're not critical, if you're not questioning, if you're looking only at the issue, I wanted to follow this path. My mentor is saying follow this path. Can I do a quick SWOT analysis? Which path is better? No, I'm not getting an answer. Can I go back to my mentor and sit down and argue it out? Please convince me. Why are you saying that we have to go by this path when I feel that this path is better? Mentor will say something. You may not agree. Go back and think it over. In certain cases, there you are very adamant, I don't want to change. You should still have the type of relationship with your mentor that you go back and say, please excuse me. On this one aspect, I'm going to follow my own conscience or my own thinking. Okay? That does not mean that I don't look up to you as a mentor. That does not mean that I don't want you as a mentor or I'm not going to take advice in other areas. Come, let's move forward in other areas. That is a beautiful mentor-mentee relationship. Vinita says, like we have wonderful mentors in Banjara. Yes, Vinita, that's what I keep telling. No, whether it is Banjara, whether it's in your neighborhood, whether it is some shopkeeper or a security man near about you, you inevitably have some mentors, some people who have certain, what we call as, you know, basic experience of life. Some people who have seen ups and downs and have learned so much from it that they can look at life in a much more mature, much more broad-minded manner. And if you have not had the same experiences, you are at a developmental phase. And remember, developmental phase can be at 18 or 80. It doesn't make a difference. If you are progressing, that mentor will be in a position to help you, guide you in whatever way. Asha says, growth is important for both mentor and mentee. Yes, that's a very nice point that you made, Asha. In fact, if you are a mentee and your mentor is really helping you, guiding you and ensuring your growth, sometime take time off to tell the mentor, can we talk about you today? How is your growth? How is your learning? How is your progress? It's not just a one-way relationship. Most of the time you are guiding me. You're mentoring me. I'm not going to mentor you. I'm not at that level, but still I would like to know something more about it. And if you find that your mentor is also learning and growing, it can be a wonderful long-term relationship between the two of you. Vinita says, absolutely, Ali. I still remember one of my school teachers told me few life lessons which are still so fresh in my mind and has helped me a lot in every stage of my life. For me, my parents were also great mentors, as I have learned a lot from them, and I think I am blessed and grateful for having few wonderful mentors in my life. Absolutely right, Vinita. And here I bring you to another point. What about your own parents? Most parents, in some way or the other, are also our mentors. And more so when we grow up. See, when we are small, we are directly under the control of the parents, and they are more worried about, you know, ensuring that you do the right things, you do your studies, you do your grooming, you do keep your health and all that. But once you have become an adult, if you can still have that type of equation with your parents, those of us who are lucky to have our parents with us, it's a great blessing. Because as they grow older, they may not be very functional because of age. Your father may have retired, your mother may be not keeping very great health, so she done has passed on the domestic work to somebody, a junior, whatever it is. But experience, wisdom, and that too from a person who has learned to grow, learned to learn, and has an open mind. Such people can be really great mentors, whether they are your parents, your teachers, your neighbors, anybody. Shobha says, "Hi Ali, my lifetime is you and Banjara family. After contacting you, my life and my thought process are changed in a better and mature way. Because of my Facebook friend, I follow you and I started to learn in my life." Thank you so much, Shobha. That's a really great compliment, and I feel humbled to just read what you have written about me and the entire Banjara team. And that is what we try to do whenever it is possible. Whenever we feel that we can mentor somebody by small, small things, we always make that attempt. Whenever we discuss among ourselves as part of Team Banjara or the Banjara family, we always look at people, students who have come in, our volunteers, our counselors, our alumni who have passed out but who are keeping in touch. With any of these people, we are always looking to see whether there's something that we can do. Just the other day, somebody had come for aptitude testing from a far off city. And then I realized that one of our old alumni lives there. So I asked this person that, can I send a little letter and a small little gift to that person? Will you go there? I will ask her to come and pick it up from you. This parent of the child who had come for aptitude testing said, sure, why not? If you want, I can even go to that person. They are not in a very big city. I can even deliver it to them. Now, this is the type of thing which helps us to keep that contact, to be able to learn from each other, to be able to, you know, that reach out in a small way here and there. Asha says, sometimes arguments does not end up becoming frivolous. Yes, we have to take it as part of the life's journey. Arguments are there. Sometimes interactions become frivolous. As long as you are aware of what is happening, as long as you know the issue why the argument took place, then you can really move on. Lifetime mentor, I met Ali Shobha. Yes, 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 I do understand, Shobha. Raji is here. Good to have you, Raji. Rajeshwari Nag. Can we choose non-human mentors? That is a lovely thought that you have provoked. There are some animals who can really teach us more about life than human beings, the way they behave. Particularly, I have this fondness for dogs. Right from street dogs to any type of dogs, my friends, pets, anybody like that. And I find that sometimes they can teach us so much. Those of you who have seen that very touching Japanese movie, Hachiko, it's about a dog who is a street dog who used to follow a gentleman who used to go by train. He used to follow him to the railway station. That man used to go off to work. Evening when he comes back, the dog would be waiting outside the station and walk back with him to the home. One day that gentleman caught a train and went to his place of work, passed away. And not even his dead body was brought back. And this dog spent the whole evening and night waiting for him. And he spent the next day and the next week and the next month and the next year. The dog continued sitting outside the station through rain and shine, till he became very old and he passed away. I mean, what great lessons these people teach us. They are, you know, they cannot speak. They cannot teach us things which a human mentor can teach, but if we are willing to learn. In fact, next month, on 17th, I have taken up a topic which I've already started exploring on, make friends with plants. Many of us make friends with animals, but how many of us make friends with plants, and what do we learn from them? I'm collecting it, and as I always keep reminding, anything that you have to contribute, please let me know. Send it in by whatever form, email or text message or whatever, or call up and tell me. I would love to have inputs from you on these topics. So you know the topics for the next 3-4 weeks. Anytime that you have some idea, some pointers about any of those topics, please send them in, because I keep preparing well in advance. Dr. Shirin is here. Lovely to have you, Shirin. I have read that parents should find a mentor for their child early in life, an elder in the family or whom the child understands. This helps the child to express apart from the parents. What you have heard is absolutely right, Shirin. If I have that magnanimity and that broad-mindedness to say, I am the parent. I have total control over my child. I will do the best for my child. I'm willing to give my life for my child. But the child is an independent entity. The child has their own thinking, emotions, attitudes. If I can provide a good mentor to my growing child, so that, number one, the child has another adult with whom they can talk, they can express, they can bring out their emotions and simultaneously learn a few lessons. So when the child looks at mother or father, they should not be the only two adults in the life. So if there is a grandfather, if there is an uncle, if there is a neighbor, if there is a teacher who can be a mentor to my child, I think I'm doing a great service to my child by providing the opportunity for my child to have a mentor. Shobha says, thank you so much, Ali. Please, you and Banjara family, come to Chikmagalur. Yes, Chikmagalur is such a lovely place. I've been there a couple of times long back, and I love the greenery, the openness, the serenity of that place. It's not, technically speaking, a hill station or a tourist place, but it has a lot of, you know, nature. It has a lot of things to offer, which I think those of us who live in Bangalore or in these major, you know, big cities, I think we miss out on. So whether it is Chikmagalur or any other place, I think, in fact, now that Shobha has mentioned this, let me also tell you, nature can also be a good mentor. Why only restrict to non-humans or animals? Even nature can be a good mentor. Nature teaches us one of the most important lessons of life, and that is delayed gratification. Nature teaches us that you may be the richest man in the world, but you cannot change the weather. If it is summer and it is hot, you have to wait for the monsoon, which will come at its own time. If you've enjoyed the monsoon, but now the monsoon is getting too much on you and your movement is getting restricted because of heavy rains, you cannot do anything about it. You have to wait for the season to change. There's so many things that nature teaches. I have been a great lover and admirer of nature, and I think nature has also taught me wonderful things. So those of you particularly who don't live, who are not fortunate like Shobha to live in places like Chikmagalur, I would request you, whenever, whatever length of time, whenever you get opportunities, do go and spend time with nature. Yes. Rina says, my grandfather was my greatest mentor. He taught me cycling and many great things. That's very, very, very true. You know, A grandfather who is teaching his little grandchild like Rina how to cycle. It is not just the physical act of, you know, holding the cycle and balancing it and pushing the child. When the grandfather does this, the child also learns what it means to take risks, what it means to have that confidence and know that, yes, grandfather will never let me go. So see how the child is learning during the growing years. When the child has the attention and affection of the grandfather, teaching cycling is only an excuse to spend quality time together. And during that time, the appreciation which the grandfather gives, the lessons which the grandfather teaches, the questions that the grandfather asks, showing concern and interest in the grandchild, that automatically becomes a mentoring process. Asha says, even sunshine, breeze helps to make a decision. Definitely, I agree with you. We in India are very fortunate to have sunshine literally 12 months of the year. Talk to people who live in very cold countries. There, the sun hardly ever shines. They suffer, many people in such countries suffer from a disorder called SAT, seasonal affective disorder. When winter comes, all colors disappear. Everything becomes gray. Everything becomes dull. The bright sunshine disappears for days together. The grass and the trees disappear. And you're caught up. It's so cold to even step outside that you're huddled in your own homes with your heaters or fire or whatever it is. You crave for that sunshine. And you and I, who live in India, take sunshine for granted. But sunshine can really bring sunshine into our lives. These are very, very small, apparently insignificant things. But if we have that capacity to stop and think, as I always keep quoting the proverb, take time off to stop and smell the flowers. There are flowers all around you. Many a time we don't even notice. We just walk past them without giving a second thought to them. But if we can take the trouble of stopping, looking at a flower, smelling it, appreciating it, and then walking further ahead, it energizes you. It gives you a higher level of motivation and enthusiasm. Ah, yes, Shobha says, Kannada poet Kuvempu, what a great man he was. Kuvempu said that sunrise and sunset are the grace of God. And as a message in both sunrise and sunset, like I was telling you, delayed gratification. You may be the king or the president of a particular country, but can you dictate to the sun? Can you advance or delay the sunrise or sunset? Can you see the difference between the daytime and the darkness of the night? How much we learn from each one of these. It takes great people like Kuvempu to identify and bring it to our attention. But do we learn these lessons is the question. So once again, as I always do, I leave you with these very simple, but very meaningful and very in-depth thoughts. They are like tiny seeds, which you have now with you. It's up to you to plant it in your mind. Nurture it. It germinates. It blossoms. It grows. And it makes your life really wonderful. I would like each one of you today in the first Saturday of the year, while wishing you all a wonderful year ahead of you, I would like you to please make these small, small efforts to ensure that your quality of life, your relationship, and the lives of people around you improves as much as possible. So have a wonderful week. Anis will show you the topic of the next Saturday, which is a very unusual topic, but again, something nobody wants to talk about, the emotional aspects of a simple but a very common thing called the premenstrual syndrome, PMS. It is always neglected. It is ignored, but it plays a lot of importance, not only in the life of the person who's going through PMS, but the entire family. So that is what we are going to be discussing next Saturday, which happens to be 13th of January at 2 o'clock. So see you. Bye-bye and thanks.
Everyone, my mentor for my life is the auntie who lived in my neighborhood. She is no more, that is the saddest part, but yet I grew up seeing her with so many things in her life. She went through trauma and terminal illness, plus lot of disturbance in her personal life, but one thing she carried with her and I would like to treasure that in my life is hope. She never lost hope in any situation. She had that confidence in her. I don't know how she did that. It's not easy, yes. But she had that smile and that self-care within her was really inspiring to me. Now when I realize and go back in my thoughts, I feel that that is one of the things which I should treasure in my life. And, you know, it is really empowering.